Thank you, Professor. I will talk on the challenge and the possibilities how to reverse land degradation in Ethiopia. And this presentation is based largely on review of works, previous research works. And I will follow this outline. And as you know, Ethiopia is a very large country, both in terms of population and in terms of its geography. And we can speak that the country is roughly divided into three parts, the highland, the lowland, and the rift valley. And they have different characteristics in terms of the population density, in terms of the livelihood of the populations, and in terms of the potential for land degradation, they are relatively different. To say about agriculture in Ethiopia, it's basically agriculture is a smallholder agriculture, and this provides a lot for the economy in terms of GDP, in terms of export, and in terms of employment too. And livestock is an important integral part of the system. Coming to land degradation, I will speak these four issues: the extent and the impact of land degradation, its causes and drivers, and efforts previously undertaken to reverse the trend, and then the challenge and the problems to reverse the trend. As you know, in Ethiopia, natural degradation has been going for centuries, and almost all forms of land degradation has been occurred in Ethiopia: water and wind erosion, both physical and biological erosions. And these photos shows different kinds of land degradation on different land uses. Even compared to other countries, Ethiopia seems to be highly affected by land degradation. This bar graphs compared to the extent of land degradation in Malawi, Ethiopia, and Tanzania. As you saw, the in Ethiopian case, about 49% of the farmers' plots is affected by soil erosions, while the control or the measures taken to avert the negative consequence of land degradation is implemented only about 4% of the land. And there are different drivers of the land degradation, both at macro and micro or meso levels. And you can see that, for example, high population growth, high livestock population, poverty, low productivity growth. These are almost, we can talk macro level factors, but they have been contributing for the land degradation in the country. And at household or farm levels, there are also different contributors for this land degradation. We can talk about biophysical characteristics, demographic characteristics, and specifically the plots which the farmers farming, and there are also socioeconomic characteristics. All any measures to be undertaken to reverse the trend should have to consider almost all these factors and to find the balance where to strike. The next slide shows the land use change in Ethiopia between 2001 and 2009, and you can see the cropland. The yellow bar shows the percentage of change along the cropland, forest land, grassland, woodland, and barren and waters. And in most cases, there is in forest and grassland, this and barren, there is negative trend, while in the cropland, shrublands, and yeah, in these two, there is a positive changes. And again, this slide shows the cost of land degradation due to decline, and it shows the decline in total economic value. And you can see the between 2001 and 2009, there is a change of about 11% or 11 billion US dollar, and this is in terms of the GDP, it is amounted about 19 billion US dollars. So after this, what has been undertaken in Ethiopia by the government and by different development partners over the past four decades, there have been a lot of projects, a lot of programs have been undertaken in the country to reverse the trend, to control the damage, and to reverse even the trend. And this starts from the massive food for work programs of the mid-1970s to the present SLM programs. And this has been undertaken with massive support from donors and UN agencies. And there have been different results, some positive, some negative or incapacity to reverse the trend. But recent measures bear relatively better results, and there are different factors why this has been occurred. First, the program has been improved through times. Recent programs create more harmonized approach, and they follow a long watershed approach. There are also different factors, for example, in terms of improved support from different international agencies. There has been also improved peace and security in the country over the past decade or two decades. There is also improved weather conditions, at least over the past decades. Awareness among the farmers have been improved because of improved roads extension and other factors. And there is also better organizations at grassroots levels. However, given the magnitude of land degradation and the vastness of degraded land, as well as other compounding factors, the impact of conservation works seems comparatively small compared to the reality on the ground. And effective, sustainable, and reversible outcome can emerge only when the country breaks these cycles. At least in the most part of the country, should able to just to break these cycles. There have been currently efforts. Then I will try to talk some thoughts on how to break these cycles. These are really not from research findings, just to stimulate discussions for future actions or for future researches. And we can talk that relatively, by this time, we know better the causes, the drivers, the impact, as well as the remedies to the problems. But so far, effective programs are not sustainable. The country has also long experience in dealing with the problem and the constraints and that challenge any sustainable progress. And in the context of Ethiopia, any real and sustainable effort to reverse land degradation needs, I think, more than time-bounded and donor-funded projects. The country should have its own master plan to how to break that vicious cycle. And why master plan the country beyond any development programs or projects? We know that this land degradation has been a long history in the country, but any concerted effort by external factors has been only a short period of history, almost about 40 years ago. But the problem has been occurring in the country over many centuries. So interventions are relatively young compared to the problem. Second, the causes and the drivers of land degradation are by themselves very complex, and they are also interactive and self-reinforcing, both across space and across time. So this makes again, time also play against future interventions, because as time passes, the dynamics and the complexity of the problem intensified and reinforced due to population growth, poverty effect, maybe climate effect might also aggravate the problems. Then, despite the progress achieved so far, projects and programs undertaken in the country are either not comparable to the scale of the problems, and sometimes there is high risk of reversibility of emerged results. And because of this, sometimes programs might not be appropriate. They might address some symptoms rather than the root causes of the problems. Sometimes the interventions may be partial. That means they might too much focus on technical issues while they neglect institutional or policy factors which should be addressed together. Interventions also lack sometimes consistency, and this might be partly associated because many of the interventions are associated with foreign money. And this is my final PowerPoint. What type of master plan? It's very difficult, but we can say very few points. The master plan should match with the scale and the complexity of the problem. It should also not be considered as one-time blueprint, but it should be crafted to provide long-term solution while addressing short-term or emerging problems. This is a very difficult issue to balance, but we have to balance. And it should be also dynamic enough to respond to new findings and researches and realities on the ground. It should also be flexible to deal with and incorporate local or community interests. And finally, it should be led by technocrats with stable institutes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Samuel.